In Detroit, 1950, a young girl named Aretha splits her time between her divorced parents, Reverend C.L. Franklin and Barbara. She loves singing and loves to sing for all the guests at the family's house parties. Later, Barbara plays the piano and sings with her, tells her to remember that she doesn't have to sing for her dad if she doesn't want to, and that her voice is her own, not her father's. During one of her father's parties, an adult male guest comes upstairs and shuts the door, sexually molesting her. Aretha's grandmother notices her behavior is strange and asks her what is going on with her. Aretha won't tell, but her grandmother tells her if she can't say it to anyone, she can always say it to God. Later, the family receives the upsetting news that Barbara has died. Aretha is devastated, stops singing and even speaking altogether. At her birthday party, she won't even blow out the candles. Her father is frustrated and gives up, not knowing what to do with her. James Cleveland, a family friend and leader of the church choir, encourages Aretha that music will always save her. She agrees to tour with her father's sermons and sing. In 1958, Aretha is singing in Birmingham, working with the civil rights groups in America. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., a friend of the family, praises Aretha and invites her to do more work. But she returns back to Detroit with her father, where her grandmother is watching her two kids, which she had a result of the sexual assaults. At a house party, Ted White, a local producer, makes eyes at Aretha, who is attracted to him. CL threatens Ted to stay away from his daughter and calls him the N-word. He then surprises Aretha with tickets to New York to meet about a record deal. In New York City, she and her father meet with John Hammond at Columbia Records, who offers Aretha a recording contract. By 1960, Aretha is still making music but has never had a hit song. She continues making albums. After 3 years, she is performing at a show where a family friend singer, Dinah Washington, is in the audience. Aretha starts singing one of Dinah's songs in tribute. Dinah gets so offended she flips her table over. She meets with Aretha afterward, who is lamenting that she doesn't have any hits. Dinah tells her it's because her dad keeps picking songs that she doesn't believe in, and she needs to record that music that she believes in. Aretha remembers the trauma of her sexual assaults and sleeps in late. She arrives for her recording session an hour late. Hammond is just relieved to find Aretha, but C.L. Franklin is furious with her. This leads to an argument between him and his daughter, where Aretha says that she doesn't want to sing the songs that he picks because he doesn't pick any hits, and he slaps her in the face. He tells Hammond in front of everyone that Aretha has carried this darkness with her since she was a child. Later, Aretha runs into Ted again. He makes it clear that he is interested in her, asks her to sing for him. The two begin seeing each other. One morning, at Ted's place, Aretha sees that he has all her albums. He tells her believes he can manage her into making actual hits. Eventually, Aretha brings him home to meet her family. Her sisters are shocked, knowing how their father will react when he sees Ted. CL pulls a gun on him until his mother calms him down. Aretha tells them not only are they together, but she wants Ted to manage her. She tells her father it's what needs to happen, and he tells her she will come begging for him to take her back. By 1966, Aretha has been dropped by her record company and is married to and has a child with Ted, who is beating up club owners to get the money he is owed. Ted gets Aretha a meeting with Ted Wexler at Atlantic Records. Wexler wants to finally give her a hit record, recommends she work with some southern musicians that he knows in Alabama. Ted, who is an aggressive manager, is furious, wanting Aretha to only record in New York, but Wexler promises the musicians are the real deal. In 1967, Aretha and Ted go to Alabama to record. Ted is angry that the musicians are all white and refuses to record, but eventually, he eases in to letting Aretha record "I Never Loved a Man the Way I Loved You." That night, at the motel, Ted tells her they will not return in the morning. The manager of the studio comes by to try to make peace with Ted, but Ted hears none of it and eventually goads the manager into a physical altercation. Afterward, Ted turns his ire onto Aretha, who he assaults. Aretha leaves the recording and leaves Ted. returns home to Detroit with a black eye, where her family takes her in. Wexler tries to find Aretha, but he can't. Walking down the street, they hear Aretha's song on the radio. She reaches out to Wexler, tells her she's ready to keep recording, and hires her sisters as her backup singers. Ted returns to Aretha, apologizes and takes him back, but afterward Aretha's sisters warn her not to. They remind her that her parents fought all the time. Late one night, Aretha plays the piano and plays around with rearranging the song, Respect. Her sisters help her work out the song, which they eventually play for Wexler. Respect is a massive hit, and by 1968, Aretha is selling out Madison Square Garden. She has become a huge success, and has many hits and is famous worldwide. Aretha tells Ted that she has agreed to perform at a benefit show for her father, but he says has meetings lined up for her. When Aretha refuses, Ted physically assaults her in a hotel elevator, and she flees in the lobby. She and Ted go in for a meeting with Wexler and the whole company, including tour manager Ken Cunningham, who are so excited that they have dates lined up for a European tour for her. Ted is irate and says they refuse to do a tour, and wants Aretha to do movies, even getting in Wexler's face. But when they tell them how much the tour will be worth, Ted relents and they begin the tour. In Amsterdam, the press asks Aretha about the article about her in Time magazine, which has witnesses saying that they saw Ted assault her in the hotel. Ted is furious, saying he will sue the magazine, but Aretha angrily asks him how he could do that since the article is true. This leads to a vicious argument between the two, where Aretha demands better treatment from him, but eventually, she says she's had enough and kicks Ted out for good. She needing comfort, so she calls Ken. He comes to her side and the two begin a romantic relationship. Martin Luther King Jr. is assassinated, devastating Aretha and her entire circle. Aretha sings at his funeral and afterwards sits at the bar with CL, who picks a fight with her when she says she supports a more radical approach to civil rights, like the kind Angela Davis has taken on. He accuses her of not walking in the spirit. She goes on to publicly voice support for Davis in the press. By 1970, Aretha and Ken are together and have their own child in a massive mansion in Los Angeles. When her crew tries to lessen her tour schedule, since Aretha has a habit of missing shows, they think she has been drinking too much and giving in to her demons. Aretha viciously lashes out at all of them, including her own sisters, telling everyone she pays for all of them and they all need her. She shows up to a concert drunk and falls off the front of the stage. Ken tells her he can't do this anymore. Aretha begins drinking herself into a stupor alone, until she sees a vision of Barbara, who holds her and sings Amazing Grace. The next day, Aretha begins sobering up and reconciles with Ken. In 1972, she goes to Wexler, tells him she wants to make her next album a gospel album. He isn't sure about it, but ultimately comes around to supporting her. Suggests a camera crew document it to show white audiences about that part of her life. The live album is set to be recorded in a church, and James Cleveland helps arrange everything. During a rehearsal, she breaks down in tears, and James comforts her. She tells him she cannot fall apart like that in front of the cameras. James tells her that God will be there, and that God knows what happened to her as a child was not her fault. Aretha's entire family shows up for the recording of her album, including her father, who apologizes for what he said to her about not walking in the spirit. Aretha begins singing that the album went on to be her greatest selling album of all time. Finally, the film ends with footage of the real Aretha Franklin. Thanks for watching, take care, and see you in the next video. Man, I've been fearless, I let them feel this. You know, I spit it, no cap when I killed this.